Hachette Audio presents LeaderShift, written by Orrin Woodward and Oliver DeMille, read by Orrin Woodward and Oliver DeMille.
What is a LeaderShift? Every once in a while, in the course of history, a LeaderShift occurs. It usually comes unexpectedly, and it transforms the world for at least a generation. Past LeaderShifts include the historical switch from kings and chiefs to community fathers, such as doctors, lawyers, and town merchants. The 1880s to 1920s transition from city fathers to titans of industry, like Carnegie, Morgan, and Rockefeller. The 1940s to 1970s shift from business tycoons to managers, spurred by the work of Edward Deming, and innovators from Jack Welch to Sam Walton. The 1980s and 1990s transition from managers to leaders, influenced by sages like Buckminster Fuller, Earl Nightingale, and Stephen Covey. Today, we are in the early stages of another great transition. Is your family, business, or nation prepared for the coming LeaderShift?
Part 1.
Chapter 1. Still watching, Mr. President. Nothing this year so far. Or this decade, the small man replied. Or even the last 4 decades, he muttered as he turned and walked down the long hallway. His shoulders were slumped in what looked like disappointment. But those who knew him well understood that his feelings were a lot closer to despair.
Good night, David, Marcus said. I'll call tomorrow afternoon. David waved as Marcus checked his watch and walked toward his BMW. David smiled. Marcus checked his watch a lot whenever he had a new one and wanted to be sure everyone admired it. This time it was a new Tag Heuer Grand Carrera with the Leisure Racing Band, and Marcus had mentioned in passing that it only cost him $10,000. Last weekend it had been a voucher on Constantine. David shook his head. That's just the world we live in, sad as it is. Whoever has the most toys wins and all that. He turned and walked along the water of his private estate. The old feeling of frustration immediately came back as the lights from Marcus's car left the driveway and turned onto the main road. David had enjoyed the lighter mood during dinner with Marcus, but now the old worry returned. I used to think that way too. David switched on his iPhone and glanced at the news updates. Arguments in Washington about tax increases, new regulations, partisan battles, fuel prices. He put the phone back into the safety of his pocket and kept walking. I'd rather have Marcus's interest in shopping than the national addiction to bigger government. Thinking of these two things in the same sentence made him smile. Together, these two views just about sum up today's America, he sighed. When he reached the end of the dock, he stopped and leaned on the rail. The lights from the city across the bay reflected off the water. It was beautiful, and David forced himself to listen to the waves against the dock and feel the breeze rather than think about the thing. David Mersher had been the CEO of IndyTech for almost 2 decades, and the company he had founded was now a leading growth firm despite the struggling national and world economy. He had won more awards than he cared to remember, and his family was the joy of his life. His wife, Amy, had been his business partner from the beginning. And with his oldest daughter, Emily, finishing grad school this spring, many of his friends were suggesting that he relax more and enjoy the fruits of his success. You've earned it, they told him. Let others worry about the direction of the nation. It's not your problem. He took a deep breath of the ocean air. I need to face this thing head on. It's time to deal with it. It's festered too long. I know how to deal with these things just like I always have, directly and immediately. David squared his shoulders and confronted the challenge he'd been feeling for months. America is my homeland. I've been blessed with a wonderful wife and 4 hardworking children. Professionally, my life has been a blast, owning my own company and specializing in corporate turnarounds. I should be able to just relax and enjoy life. But America's story is not inspiring. Well, not right now, anyway. It is bankrupting itself. Interest on the national debt is one of America's greatest expenses. The welfare state has bred generational poverty, and a widespread loss of self-respect. Our national credit rating will most likely keep getting downgraded, and the international warring factions have turned our military into the world's largest police force. With each passing election, many Americans think their vote has created some change, but the simple truth is, things keep heading in the wrong direction no matter who is in office. Although I have been blessed personally with a beautiful family and a thriving business, what will that matter if freedom disappears from neglect? What kind of country will my children and grandchildren live in if leaders don't begin to arise in our generation, as they did in the founding era? This is my problem. It is. In fact, this is everyone's problem. It's the biggest problem of our lives. And the more successful we've been, the more our leadership is needed. We don't need more watches or cars or more taxes and regulations. We need leaders. We need a nation of citizens who are leaders. David's thoughts turned more personal. For whatever reason, God has blessed me with the ability to identify the underlying systems of decline in corporations, and then the ability to initiate a turnaround by redesigning the flawed systems. I've made millions doing just that. I know the answer. Since America is my home, I know I have to get involved in its turnaround. I spent the first half of my life achieving success in the corporate sector. So why not spend the second half influencing the public sector to ensure the same opportunities for future generations? So many of my colleagues are building homes in other nations. New Zealand, Monaco, Costa Rica. They see the same problems in America, and yet they use their money and leadership to get away. Permanent vacations, I guess. Now that he had taken on this project, David applied the same intense focus that had made him so adept at seeing through business failures over the years and understanding what was needed to turn a company around. It usually only took a few key changes, and then relentless execution in following through. And that always meant the right kind of leadership. What are the key changes needed in America? David began to analyze with his trained expertise. For him, this was a discipline, an art and a science all rolled into one. First, America's original foundational principles are in various states of disrepair through ignorance and neglect. They must be relearned and rebuilt. David drew a deep breath. This certainly won't be easy. In fact, even though I have had plenty of tough assignments in my life, this will be my biggest undertaking by far. With so many Americans looking to the government as a nanny to take care of them, liberty is on its last legs. Running against the current is never an easy task, but when it's necessary, leaders must do it. Like one of my first mentors used to say, "When the going gets tough, the tough get going." America is in a tough spot, and the tough need to get going. David reflected on what he called the five laws of decline, FLD. He had seen these in action in his work with a number of corporate clients. Similar to how gravity must constantly be overcome in order for a plane to fly, each entity must overcome its own FLD to grow. In truth, it's not too much to say that this systematic approach to analyzing corporations is what has catapulted me to the top among turnaround specialists. While it used to take me months to identify the root causes of a company's decline, now this can be accomplished in just a few weeks or less, simply because these principles are based upon human nature that hasn't changed at all in recorded history. Now, apply these same principles to the nation. History is full of examples of empires that violated the FLD and fell over time. Greece, Rome, and the British Empire are three applicable case studies. Thankfully, one doesn't have to read the thousands of history books, economics books, and political tracts to capture the essence of the FLD. The United States today is experiencing all five laws of decline. It's time to figure out what is needed for effective turnaround. David stopped to reflect. Okay, time to let in the emotion. My walk this evening has filled me with a sense of responsibility to apply the FLD to our own country before it's too late. Actually, I've been feeling this way for a long time. But whom should I talk to?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.